Well, here we go. Just about 6:02 on Wednesday morning, July 28th. Let me see. No, 26th. See, I've got the glasses in instead of the contacts today and just not used to it yet. So on this Wednesday, July 26th, this is Up North News Radio. I'm back right alone coming up today. We will have author Samuel Friedman. He's written several books, and the latest is about young Hubert Humphrey and the way that he dragged the Democratic Party almost kicking and screaming into the 20th century by giving a speech 75 years ago last week at the Democratic National Convention about embracing civil rights. Keep in mind, the Democratic Party was very much a segregationist party for the longest time until folks like young Hubert Humphrey came around, and we'll ask about where Wisconsin's leaders were on the subject back during that time as well. And so look for that coming up at 7:30. We'll also have this week's Climate Check report from Melissa Baldoff talking about environmental justice. Headlines, Melissa Kay from Locally Grown Radio, and Todd Alba all coming up. The radio show gets started after news and commercials at 6:06. So we'll see you in just about 3 minutes. Right after I see where our thunderstorms are. Okay. All right, now let's go do some temperatures.
All across Wisconsin from Civic Media, this is Up North News Radio. Now, live from our Lake Wissota studio, here's the founding editor of Up North News, Pat Breitlow.
Well, hey there, Wisconsin. Good morning. Welcome to the state of Wiscommon Sense. From up here on the rainy shores of Lake Wissota, where we have thunderstorms rumbling through, but It's still a beautiful day up north. It is a Wednesday, July 26th. It is 71 degrees up here on Lake Wissota. Pretty consistent temperatures around the state as some showers move through. 70 degrees in Waukesha, in Wisconsin Rapids, in Wausau. 71 in Oshkosh, 67 in Amory, where folks are hearing us on Lake Air Radio all across the Civic Media Radio Network. Nice to have you along. Got some nice segments for you coming up this morning, surrounded by some headlines and other chatter. And at 6:30, we'll have our weekly climate check report with Melissa Baldoff. And we'll talk about the hostile climate out there for folks who don't really have a lot of political voice or power. You see, there's a growing push in government to ensure that vulnerable populations, the ones most impacted by a changing climate, can start to have their voices heard when it comes to preventing future damages or addressing current concerns. But naturally, there's one political party that thinks that's a terrible idea and is opposing Governor Tony Evers' efforts to embrace it. We'll also talk about the settlement that's been reached, avoiding a crippling strike against UPS and marking a big win for American workers. In our second hour, we have an author talking about their new book, one that I'm looking forward to reading and hearing more about, all about the day that Hubert flipped the script. This is the 75th anniversary of the 1948 Democratic Convention, when a young Minneapolis mayor named Hubert Humphrey helped his party escape its slide toward irrelevance and find the courage to throw off the dead weight that came from decades of racism. The author, Samuel Friedman's new book, describes how the future vice president went from naive dreamer to modern leader, and will ask how Wisconsin's leaders at the time handled the long march toward embracing civil rights. So Sam Friedman coming up at 7:30 this morning here on Up North News Radio. And along the way, if you've got questions or comments, you can call us at 844-967-2789. It might be that you're watching the video feed and your question is, why are you in glasses today and why do you look half dead? And the reason is one that you might have heard in previous family visits. I know that Aaron's probably heard it and has gotten sick of it. Good morning, Mr. Zommers. But once again, I have been visited by grandchildren who I love dearly. But then I see the runny nose and the sniffles, and next thing I know, a day or so later, I'm feeling absolutely walloped. I love those kids, but my God, they're little petri dishes. They're little vectors, is what they are.
They always are. It's unavoidable. Oh,
goodness, I feel like I've been living off of ibuprofen for the past 24 hours plus here, just solid. But we will, carry on through the day here. I was already planning to take Friday off as we wrap up our staycation together here. I'm going to tell you tomorrow is 50-50 at this point, but we'll see how things go. But again, if you want to offer chicken noodle soup recipes or anything, you can reach us at 844-967-2789. Down there, showers, thunderstorms reach you guys yet, or are you still quiet?
Well, the ground's wet. If it rained last night, I slept through it.
Well, that's actually what got me up this morning was not my alarm, but just some very loud claps of thunder right around 3:45. And you look at your phone and you go, I could sleep for a few minutes more. And then comes some more thunder and you go, yeah, that's not really happening there, is it? So, nature will do its alarm clock whenever it wants to do it. And there's really not much you can do about it, Civic Pints is the blood drive that's going on I hear, Aaron, that it has been extended, if I heard correctly, that it no longer ends at the end of July, or was I by any chance misinformed?
That sounds right, although I'm not 100% certain.
Yeah, I believe it was, because again, it'll still be summer after next week. And on top of that, there are so many more prizes to give away. I mean, we're talking dozens of Milwaukee Brewers tickets and Wisconsin State Fair tickets and Civic Media swag. And all you've got to do is do your part to help the way that blood banks run low during the summertime, as some folks get out of the habit of regular donations like they might do during the school year. So get in, donate blood, take a selfie while you're doing it, and then post it to social media with the hashtag CivicPints. P-I-N-T-S, like a pint of blood, and you could be eligible to have your name plucked out of a I don't know. Do we pluck them out of a hat here or out of one of those bags that they collect blood in? I'm not really sure. But they'll pick your name out, and you could win one of these prizes, one of these cool prizes.
Yeah, we have so many of them. It'd be a shame to end it at the end of the month when we're definitely still going to have more.
Oh, yeah. The need will still very much be out there. So keep that in mind as well. The Up North News daily newsletter comes out every weekday morning. And Christina Laurie was on with us yesterday and let us know that, you know, this week marks the 175th anniversary of the University of Wisconsin. And actually, that date is today. It was July 26th, 1848. That Wisconsin's first governor and legislature officially created the UW. And so in our newsletter today, all kinds of historical notes and rankings about the UW system, along with some other of the day's headlines as well, not to mention a father-son duo from Hayward, which is advancing ahead in the latest season of American Idol, and so much more. So go to upnorthnewswi.com and sign up for our newsletter there. Come on back. We'll do a few headlines before we talk to Melissa Baldoff about the concept of an Office of Environmental Justice. So much more still ahead wherever you are across Wisconsin on this rainy, stormy morning. You're up north.
The link you add to The Hustle, it has a really long intro. I scooted it forward to where we all
good, thank you.
Expect it to be. Okay, mm-hmm. I just wanted to make sure you didn't have a reason for that.
No, I don't. All right, there we go. Thought I might have lost you there for a minute, Aaron, as we came back from break. Or it was just I was putting all these 80 birthday candles into the cake for one Michael Philip Jagger. Mick Jagger turns 80 years old today. A little undercover of the night for you there. The Brewers trailed 4-0 last night before nearly coming all the way back against the Cincinnati Reds. The key point there is nearly. The Reds outlasted a bottom-of-the-ninth Brewers rally that included a 3-run homer with 2 outs from Christian Yelich as the Reds beat the Brewers 4-3 and reduced Milwaukee Central Division lead to a half game. Even after the home run, the Brewers had the tying run on second, the potential winning run on first, before the Reds got the final out. Milwaukee had runners on first and third with one out in the second inning, but failed to score when Andrew Monasterio got thrown out, attempting to score all the way from first on a Victor Caratini two-out double to right. And I don't even mean that he was thrown out at the plate. I mean, he was just a dead duck. The ball had come all the way in from right field to the Reds catcher, and Monasterio still wasn't even in the frame at that point, which has me questioning the third base coach, but that's what fans get to do, is question these things. The Brewers and Reds meet one more time this afternoon at American Family Field, and then that'll wrap up the season series. But, I mean, they really packed it all into the core of the season. This is the 13th matchup between the two teams since the start of June. And if you go back to May 25th, the Reds have been one of baseball's hottest teams. They have gone 32-9 against all other teams except the Brewers. But again, since late May, the Reds have gone 3-9 against the Brewers, which is why the Brewers still have a half-game lead on this otherwise red-hot Cincinnati team. Freddy Peralta will get the start today. The Brewers are off tomorrow. They will travel to Atlanta to take on the Braves for the weekend, then Washington, D.C. to take on the Nationals for another series before they are back home next week Thursday for a division series against the Pittsburgh Pirates. And you can hear the Brewers in the Fox Valley on Oshkosh Air Support, 98.3 FM, 1100 AM, and News from the Center and Richland Center, 107.7 FM, 1450 AM. All right, off to some headlines. As always, you can react to them. You can vent a little about them. You can share what else is on your mind with a statewide radio audience by calling 844-967-2789. Or you can comment on the video feed that you could find on the Up North News Facebook page, the Civic Media Facebook page. We're also on the Facebook pages of Bull Falls Radio out of Wausau and 93.5 The Tap FM out of Chippewa Falls. We'd love to see your comments. Get your questions as well. And one of the first things that we should mention is that there will not be a potentially crippling strike against the national economy by Teamsters with the United Parcel Service. The Teamsters and UPS reached an agreement to end the threat of a walkout by more than 325,000 union members. The union reported in June that its UPS members had voted to authorize a walkout when the current agreement expires next week, August 1st, with a 97% yes vote for striking. This would have hurt. UPS handles about one quarter of the tens of millions of packages that are shipped daily in the United States. It really would have put a dent in economic activity, especially in the e-commerce industry, writes the New York Times in reviewing the agreement. Representatives from more than 150 Teamster locals will meet on Monday to review the agreement. They will vote between August 3rd and August 22nd. But right now, all indications are that the Teamsters and members are happy about it. Teamsters President Sean O'Brien said in a statement, "We demanded the best contract in the history of UPS, and we got it." I'm going to kill my mic for just a second here and take a little sip of coffee and give a little cough. See, again, grandkids, Aaron. Maybe the hazmat suit next time before this happens, but
I'm sure you could find one on eBay.
And now it will be delivered, thanks to not having this UPS strike. So what are some of the deals here? Well, the Teamsters said under the tentative agreement, current, full, and part-time UPS employees represented by the union would get an hourly raise of $2.75 and then $7.50 an hour in raises throughout the course of the contract. The minimum pay for part-timers will rise to $21 an hour, far above the current minimum starting pay of $16.20 an hour, and the top rate for full-time delivery drivers will rise to $49 an hour. Full-time drivers currently make $42 an hour on average after 4 years. The company has pledged to create 7,500 new full-time union jobs and to fill 22,000 open positions for which part-time workers will be eligible. This came about, all of these particulars, because the company had talked about creating a new class of worker. UPS had said it was an arrangement that would allow workers to take on dual roles like sorting packages some days and driving on other days, especially Saturdays. But the Teamsters said the hybrid idea was never actually carried out, and that in practice, the new category of workers drove full-time Tuesday through Saturday only for less pay than the other drivers. What you should read into that, well, first off, is all about the merits of union representation, because otherwise the company was going to jam these new duties, you know, down workers' throats, and they were not going to have any voice. They were not going to be able to do anything about it. It happens in far too many workplaces where, again, it's death by a thousand paper cuts. Well, you can take on this extra role. Oh, you did that. Well, you can take on this extra role. Oh, you did that. I know it was tough, but here, you're going to take on this extra role and continue to push people to the breaking point for little to no extra pay if those workers don't have some kind of seat at the bargaining table, some kind of representation, some kind of leverage. And so, again, while there are many people who say, you know, we don't need labor unions, you're benefiting because of this deal. This deal and everything else that workers have won throughout the years through negotiations benefits everybody in time. I mean, that's the real trickle-down economics, is the fact that, you know, we have things like the 40-hour work week or weekends or paid holidays or children not working in coal mines. You know, these are the things that we all benefit from when you level the playing field a bit, because the people who are doing the work for you are being treated more fairly and not being treated like chattel, but being treated like, you know, an asset rather than a liability. So these are the kinds of things that we should be celebrating in the UPS, agreement, and the fact that there's not going to be a strike, but instead, you know, a new generation of workers who are getting adequately paid and not being, treated with this, you know, quote unquote hybrid role, which was just another way to, you know, get more while paying the same. Another article that caught my eye was, this one's also coincidentally in the New York Times. It's the newest essay from Thomas Edsel, who does occasional columns on politics and demographics. And this one, he goes off in several different directions about the differences between Democrats and Republicans or conservatives and progressives. But there's one topic that I find rather fascinating, and that's the subject of this particular column, and that is Americans' views on masculinity and what that translates to in terms of your politics. And Tom Edsel looks at two books published last year, very different in tone, as he puts it. You've got Richard Reeves, who wrote Of Boys and Men, and then you've got manly man, Senator Josh Hawley, whose book was called Manhood, The Masculine Virtues America Needs. And of course, Josh Hawley comes at this from a decidedly right-wing point of view, which is full of bluster, but nothing that really supports it. No menace to this nation is greater than the collapse of American manhood, he declares, placing full blame on the American left. And in fact, they have helped drive it. In power centers they control, places like the press, the academy, and politics, they blame masculinity for America's woes. And on and on he goes. Again, the guy who ran scared out of the U.S. Capitol on January 6th. Reeves, meanwhile, paints a downbeat picture of the state of men, but contends the solutions lie in an expansion of the progressive agenda, noting that men account for 2 out of 3 deaths of despair, either from a suicide or an overdose. Boys and men of color and those from poorer families are suffering most, in part because of a huge gender gap in education. There's a big gap in what might be called personal agency, he writes. that men are now only about half as likely as women to study abroad or sign up for the Peace Corps or buy their own home as a single adult. And it turns out that if you translate this into voting records, again, you can really see the divide. An associate editor from Politico magazine wrote an article about a poll that asks, do you agree or disagree with the statement, the Democratic Party is hostile to masculine values? Republicans agree, 68-8. Democrats disagree, 62-6. Another one of the core differences is based on how you answer whether you agree or disagree with this statement. Traditional family structure with a wage-earning father and a homemaking mother best equips children to succeed. Republicans agree with that statement, 52% to 24%. Democrats disagree, 59% to 16%. So you've got the Republicans' point of view of, hey, gals, you know, stay home, raise the babies. If you want your family to be a success, that's the way you got to go. That is still a mentality that, for everything that women have gone through over the decades, is still, you know, very much a barrier to their acceptance in the workplace and their success in things like the wage gap. And so there continue to be more comparisons throughout this article, but again, there are some positive touchstones about Gen Z, and that Gen Z voters continue to enter the voting ranks while baby boomers continue to retire and pass away with their conservative values. And while there's no guarantee that that's something that will last into the decades, we do see more and more people in their 20s and 30s whose point of view on what men and women can do, should do, are capable of doing are much more in line with what really makes for a successful country and economy, as to one that just leads to people shaking their fists saying, get off my lawn and stay home and have babies. We'll have our climate check report with Melissa Baldoff next. You're up north. So I had this interesting conversation with Sage, who, for those watching The Secret Show, is our big boss here at the radio station. I should say, Aaron, your big boss. No, I don't actually work for the radio station. And I hope it gave him a chuckle more than anything else. The reason I'm telling you this is just for the punchline. I said, you know, we're going to be doing some branding here, and we want to be able to have some metrics to measure the show. You know, how are things growing and things. And as you know, in the radio business, it's not just about, you know, a diary of people listening live, but there's people, there's all the live streams. There's the stream through the website. There's the app. There's all these different Facebook pages and YouTube. There's podcast downloads and everything else. And we're trying to figure out how would you go about gathering all of those numbers? And as he's describing the challenge, I said, well, Sage, the one thing I'm getting from this is you can't ever fire me because you can't ever show that I'm not doing very well because the numbers are just all over the place. But we then did pick up a metric that we're going to promote and measure down the road here.
That's cool. Yeah. I think that's something that we're working on internally. Is figuring out which metrics to use here as well.
Yeah. So I'll send a note on that as we listen to Melissa here.
Sounds good. It's
electric. We're back now, and we're going to talk about the climate, our regular climate check feature here with Melissa Baldoff. And in doing so, well, Melissa and I, you know, like to think of ourselves as little capital insiders. And one of the sayings is, you know, if you're arguing process, you're losing. And that's what Republicans appear to be doing here, is arguing about the process of the way that Governor Tony Evers is trying to handle a changing climate, and especially making sure that certain vulnerable populations are no longer silent when it comes to a changing climate and, you know, the damage that it does and the way we can mitigate further harms. Melissa, good morning. How are you?
I'm doing well. How are you?
Very good, thanks. Now, at Up North News, we've done several stories about this back when Lieutenant Governor Mandela Barnes had his task force on climate change. There was something, one of the recommendations was about creating offices and positions that are related to something called environmental justice, and maybe creating an office of environmental justice, something that the Evers administration is interested in doing, something the Biden administration is interested in doing. So, Melissa, can we talk for a couple of minutes about what is the concept of environmental justice, and why would you have that kind of an office, that kind of position, that kind of a focus in your administration?
Yeah, I mean, I think what's most important is to just recognize that the climate crisis hits different communities in different ways. And, you know, the ways that our rural communities are impacted, low-income communities, urban areas, and other communities around the state, you know, are feeling that impact kind of first and worst. And having an Office of Environmental Justice, recognizing that environmental justice is important, is just saying, hey, we want to make sure that as we work towards a transition into, you know, a more sustainable approach, that we are recognizing that some of these communities are hit hardest, hit first, hit worst, and want to make sure that's a just transition that acknowledges that different communities need different things at times and is able to support people. So, you know, this really shouldn't be like so many other things. You know, this shouldn't be a fight. This shouldn't be a, you know, an issue. But, you know, I think they want, the Republicans, some of them want to gin up controversy here where there really shouldn't be any. You know, this is an effort to ultimately help the people of our state as we address climate change, which is real. And that's, I think, part of the problem is that you've got people in the legislature who don't believe that climate change is real. And that's a problem. And it's out of line with reality, for one. It's also out of line with what the overwhelming majority of Wisconsinites know to be true, is that climate change is real. And it's concerning.
Right. And it shouldn't be contentious, but it's going to be contentious anytime that you've got one group of people who is essentially looking out for the elites. You know, maybe you give them a tax cut that's overwhelmingly large compared to everybody else. But not to get too far off topic here, it also means that you're looking out for, you're not looking out for the people who are first and most affected by things like a changing climate. And one of the first examples we used at Up North News was about the Bad River Band of Chippewa and how at one point decades ago, they were forced to relocate their entire community of Odana because of the, you know, increasing impacts of flooding on the Bad River, and that other vulnerable populations are the ones who are closest to the coastlines that are being eroded. And I don't just mean the ocean. I mean, like the, you know, the Great Lakes, and I mean our rivers and things like that. You have, you know, the stronger storms, the wild fluctuations in temperature, the, you know, the sustenance farmers are the ones who are going to see the lower crop yields. We're all going to see more algae blooms. And it's those areas that an Office of Environmental Justice at least just says, hey, you know, can we consider this and not just, you know, what the McMansions are going to be going through? At least that's my interpretation of what I'm seeing.
Yeah, that's exactly right. I mean, and you think of the fact you talk to folks, especially in, you know, areas in Southwest Wisconsin who have been dealing with, you know, 500 year floods every 2 or 3 years. So, you know, this is having an Office of Environmental Justice just says, hey, we recognize that different communities are hit differently, and we want to ensure everyone's got what they need to be safe, to, you know, be able to operate their businesses, keep their communities safe.
Yeah. And it really, I see a two-pronged approach here. At the state level, the concept says that if state local governments are making decisions that affect the environment, then make sure you include the voices of those who are heavily impacted but frequently overlooked. But then at the federal level, I should say, you have the Biden administration setting up an Office of Environmental Justice inside the U.S. Department of Justice. And what they're saying is that when there are cases of environmental harm, that office puts a priority on prosecuting the cases that are impacting the communities most affected. And again, it's simply one way of making sure that government, you know, looks out for everybody, not just the people with the most money or the loudest voices.
Exactly. That's exactly right. You know, we see it not just in Wisconsin, but we see it all over the place. You know, you think about how unhealthy, unsafe the drinking water had to be in Flint for something to happen. And we see in communities around Wisconsin that there are incredibly high levels of lead in the water. And often that is an occurrence in the communities that are least equipped financially to address the issues. And like you said, it shouldn't just be that the wealthiest people, the wealthiest businesses, the wealthiest communities are able to mitigate the harm of pollution and climate change. Every community, every business, every family should have an equal opportunity to have a safe and healthy life.
And if you think that right now, Republicans running the Wisconsin legislature are in fact looking out for equal opportunities for people when it comes to environmental hazards, just keep in mind the multiple times that Republicans have said, when asked, why aren't you helping more fully fund lead pipe replacement in Milwaukee or lead pipe replacement overall, their response has been along the lines of, well, too much of that money goes to Milwaukee. To which I would respond, well,
exactly.
Yeah, that's where the problem is.
Exactly. Yep, exactly. They're, you know, it just seems that they're so worried that there could be a benefit to Milwaukee that they're willing to let the rest of the state be harmed too,
which just doesn't make sense. And if they want to make some inroads, figure out why aren't we getting more support? Well, maybe try leading the way on, you know, addressing something that is literally, you know, life altering, but, you know, they can't do that. So instead we get back to talking about the process and whether Governor Evers, in creating an Office of Environmental Justice and in looking for funding for it, because again, not everything comes through the legislature. Sometimes there are other private funds, there are federal funds and things like that. You know, is Evers doing everything without having to say, Mother, may I, every time the legislature wants to second guess what he's doing? At least that's the gist of what I got from a recent story in the Milwaukee newspaper, is that, you know, again, Republicans felt like if they can't micromanage the governor, then there must be something wrong.
Right. And, you know, you also are seeing, you know, they're kind of, you know, moaning and groaning that there could be, like you said, potentially funds coming in from outside sources. And if they have a problem with that, they could have done what the governor proposed in the budget and funded the office and then had some oversight, some input in the, you know, the funding streams that would be in that office. But they, you know, they didn't want to have the office. They didn't want to make it a priority. And now that the governor is using his authority, that he has executive authority to still create this office, you know, they want to, you know, they want to moan and groan about it and complain. And I think that's just kind of more what we expect is from them, is that, you know, they have opportunities to be part of a solution, and instead they just want to, you know, bellyache about it and do nothing. So, you know, that it's unfortunate, because that would have been, you know, one of many great opportunities to demonstrate collaboration, a willingness to work together, be bipartisan, because, you know, the climate crisis is not a partisan issue. It is impacting everybody. And Republicans really could be part of the solution, but instead they just want to, you know, they want to complain about the solutions the governor is coming up with, you know,
well,
absent their support.
And unfortunately, what happens too often is as we've seen them do with Governor Evers and with Attorney General Josh Call, is to look for ways to officially curtail the kinds of things that the executive branch can do. You see it at the federal level with the ongoing efforts to try to restrict things like the Environmental Protection Agency. And yet, see, these are some of the same people that, I mean, my first thought, snarky as it is that, well, if only Governor Evers had done this through, you know, Jared and Ivanka, I guess that would be fine then, because that seems to be how it often happens, is that, you know, Rudy Giuliani goes to handle it or Paul Manafort goes to handle it. Governor Evers is trying to do it through the rule book, which also means that it takes longer and you open yourself up to criticism, but at least it has more transparency than it does when you just get a buddy to do these things instead. You know, that's my two cents anyway.
Exactly. Yep. I think that's right.
So that's where we'll look from here. And that's, so in this week's climate check, we wanted to give an update on what one governor's been trying to do about, you know, the climate and mitigating its impacts on vulnerable populations. And, you know, you've got a legislature that could either help in that effort, or they could argue process, which is, again, you know, why they're losing on matters about climate and matters about, you know, a governor who still, again, they'd like to point at his high disapproval numbers, but he's still got these approval numbers they could only wish for. Melissa Baldoff, thanks for taking a few minutes and helping us explain what this week's issue is. Take care. We'll talk again soon.
Sounds good. Thanks.
All right, let's do a little follow-up on a previous discussion from just yesterday when we talked to Hans Breitenmoser and Sarah Lloyd, and we talked about anti-competitive practices that are impacting Wisconsin farmers. And in a note from a Wisconsin Public Radio article, Wisconsin Attorney General Josh Call is going to join a group of other state attorneys general to work with federal officials on such anti-competitive practices in agriculture. There will be at least 31 AGs that are taking part in some of these practices that aren't just hurting farmers, but, you know, Wisconsin-based food processors and suppliers. They'll be looking for instances of price gouging and other retail practices. And it's going to start with a rather broad focus so that it makes it easier to identify, you know, specific practices. It's something that has come up in past Democratic administrations. I know early on, the Obama administration was asked to look into anti-competitive practices in big dairy, especially in cheese making. Certainly, there's going to be that impact in other states. The National Farmers Union did a campaign starting a couple of years back, asking both state and federal officials to just enforce the existing antitrust laws and try to bring back a sense of balance to market power between the people who are farming and, you know, the large corporations. We really saw this in the pandemic when any given meatpacking plant suddenly had all kinds of workers catching COVID and many of them dying. And it was only then that I think a lot of us really became aware that I think it's something like, you know, four huge companies control so much of the meat supply. And when you have very few, but very large processing operations, not only is that bad for the food supply, but that can certainly lead to, you know, anti-competitive practices and higher prices than you otherwise would if you encouraged a whole lot of, you know, non-ginormous state-based entities. And so that and other things will be looked at over the course of the next, I don't know if it'll be, it could be months, could be years. And while nothing's going to happen quickly on it, the fact that conversations like the ones we had here on the radio yesterday and like state attorneys generals are having right now tells us that at least there is the possibility for some progress in getting farmers and local producers some better prices just through bringing competition back to the free enterprise system. All right, we're slated to have Melissa Kay from locally grown radio, WFHR in Wisconsin Rapids, coming up. There she is chiming in right now. So we'll have today's history lesson and music break coming up in just a bit. You're up north. Miss Melissa, how are you?
Hi, I'm pretty good. How are you?
I am good, thank you.
Good.
Let's see. Get to my notes. Where are you? There we go.
Aaron, we just need to add a stripe of blue behind you, and you look like you have, you know, like a French flag or
yes,
something.
Yes, in
there.
Fact, yes, that's exactly it.
Yeah, you're yeah. Right. Da, 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 da.
There we go. You got it.
Love it.
Oh, I suppose I got to tell you like what's going on. I should look.
Yes.
It's been a busy morning. I'm covering for Brittany this week too. So lots going on.
Yeah, no kidding. Are you Sheepshead player?
Sheepshead. No. Yeah. Okay. Euchre.
Ah, okay. All right.
Or what's the other one? Pinochle? My grandpa liked pinochle.
Some people learn how to play beer pong in college. I learned how to play pinochle.
That was a smarter choice.
Honest to God, I did not know until 8 seconds ago anybody still played that anymore.
Oh, really?
Yeah. All right. Well, there, I learned something. Again, it is Mick Jagger's birthday today. Raise your hand if you're surprised that Mick Jagger made it to his 80th birthday. I see all out there, but there he goes. Mick Jagger turns 80 years old today from the Rolling Stones. Other birthdays. Where are my manners? There's a guest here. Melissa Kay from locally grown radio, WFHR. Good morning.
Good morning, Pat.
And you're doing some double duty this week, you said.
Yes, one of my colleagues is on vacation, so I'm covering news for multiple markets this week.
All right. Well, appreciate you taking a little bit of time just to play with us and do some guessing on music and birthdays and things like that.
Absolutely.
We're going to hear from Dobie Gray a little later on. His big song was Drift Away. He turns 83 today. Darlene Love, 82. And actress Sandra Bullock. You know how old she is today?
Want to take a guess? I would guess she's probably like 47.
Oh, she would love you for that. 59. She and I are just a couple of weeks apart.
Wow.
And I can't really hold a candle to her and how well you age at the age of 59. So good on her. Mm-hmm. If I said, again, I don't know why I do all these things to prove how old I am. But if I mentioned the power couple of music in the 70s, Marilyn McCoo and Billy Davis Jr., would you know the group where they met and did most of their work?
Nope.
Nah, I was afraid of that. All right. Well, those would be the two lead singers of the Fifth Dimension. And they got married this day in 1969. The Fifth Dimension went on to have many hits, but then the duo did their own, had their own hit in 1977. And of course, this is one of those, I picked a song with something like a 30-second intro. So now I've got to go on and tell you more about the Fifth Dimension. And I could have played, you know, Up, Up and Away and all those other things where you ever feel like you're the last person that still listens to a particular album or a group or anything like that. That's definitely me with the Fifth Dimension. I have a few songs of theirs on my phone. You got anything like that at all where you go, oh, nobody else has this but me?
Well, I have an odd eclectic music taste, so maybe.
Okay. Nope, that totally works. There's our bit of the Fifth Dimension there. I was looking to see if
it's very 70s.
It's extremely 70s, you know, and again, that's mid 70s as the Fifth Dimension. Marilyn McCoo did Last Night I Didn't Get to Sleep at All. There Was One Less Bell to Answer. Aquarius, Let the Sun Shine In. And of course, Up, Up and Away. So anyway, Marilyn McCoo, Billy Davis Jr. Let's see, this would make it 54 years of a marriage for them. Okay.
Oh, congratulations.
On this day in 1951, Walt Disney's 13th animated film, Alice in Wonderland, premiered in London. Gotta say, not a big Alice in Wonderland person. I'm pretty straightforward. I don't go for like the Fantasia and the, you know, the things that go off in all kinds of weird directions. Clearly other people do. I mean, there's a niche for that. Just not mine.
I directed an Alice in Wonderland ballet multiple years ago.
Oh, interesting.
Yeah, it was fun.
Okay. All right.
I know my sisters were in an Alice in Wonderland play, and the thing I remember most about it is that one of the funniest, like, local high schooler actors when I was in probably, like, fifth or sixth grade played the doorknob, and it was so funny to have him face painted with a big doorknob on his nose just sticking his head through. Oh, what are you doing? And, like, honking on my nose and all that stuff.
Cute.
Let's see. We've got another prototypical 70s song coming up here. The number one song this day in 1975. One hit wonder Van McCoy had this one. So last night I'm putting this together and I've got my 16, soon to be 17 year old grandson and a friend of his who came out as well from Idaho. And I started, you know, mentioning some of these bits of history and ask if they knew any of them. And I started the intro of The Hustle. And I said, you guys familiar with this at all? Nope, hadn't heard anything. But then the part that you just heard as they hit the chorus of Do the Hustle, they're like, oh, yeah, 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 totally know that. And they name some show or movie that it's from. And the nine-year-old also is singing some kind of song that I thought, how do you know this? But again, TV shows and cartoons, you know, they'll grab some old tunes and put them in and give music a new sense of life.
Mm-hmm.
On this day in 1971, Apollo 15 launched. Oh, this is the one I was telling the boys about yesterday. We thought Apollo 15 was so cool because it was the first use of the lunar rover. There was a car on the moon.
Driving on the moon.
Oh, I mean, this was just America had arrived. We're putting cars everywhere now. thankfully, we don't do that quite so much with cars everywhere. But
it's,
you know,
probably not gas powered, is it?
Oh, no, no, solar.
There we
yeah,
go.
Yeah, you're not going to find E85, you know, pumps anywhere, anywhere there in the Sea of Tranquility. Now, this is one I thought was good to note, that this is the anniversary of the birth of George Clinton. He was an American general and a politician, and he was born in 1739. He was the fourth vice president of the United States and one of two vice presidents who actually served as vice president for two consecutive presidents. George Clinton served under Thomas Jefferson and then James Madison. And I only bring it up because so many people see things named after Clinton, like Clintonville, you know, in Wisconsin. Mm-hmm. And there's all kinds of Clintons, but they, I'm sure younger folks go, you know, is that Bill Clinton? Like, no, 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 no. There was George Clinton. He was a
way back.
So when you see a Clinton, think of George Clinton. Mm-hmm. The number one song this day in 1986 was by Peter Gabriel. You guys ever see the video for Sledgehammer, which probably is just a regular thing now, but it was one of those big deals then. The, you know, digital animation was really starting to take off, and Peter Gabriel transformed himself into all kinds of objects and things like that. Once again, Grandpa's just waxing poetic about the early days of technology.
What's a music video?
Yeah, okay. All right, moving on. On this day in 2011, Eric Church released his breakthrough album, Chief, which included the hits Springsteen and this one, Drink in My Hand. All right, Melissa, you are so busy doing double duty, but what can you tell us about what's happening at locally grown radio these days?
Well, I do know that we are going to do an interview with the Wood County Board Chairman, Lance Plimmel, today on our morning magazine segment, which moved to the afternoons. And I know tomorrow we have Hoozles Rise to Music happening in Rome, Wisconsin at Hoozles at the Lake. It's our second annual competition with this, and it's bringing local musicians and helping them rise up through the music industry. It'll be six local musicians competing for that number one spot.
Very cool. Melissa, thank you so much. And thanks for doing a little triple duty with us today, along with all your other goings on. Have a wonderful
day. My pleasure. You too.
All right. When we come back, we are going to be talking in our next hour with author Samuel Friedman and his new book about how Hubert Humphrey helped Democrats avoid the slide toward irrelevance and actually embrace civil rights and the future. That's up next. You're up north. That is all she wrote.
Good.
Thanks, Melissa, so much.
Yeah. Good to see you guys.
George Clinton, I just think of Parliament Funkadelic.
Oh, totally whiffed on that. Should have come up with that.
Next time.
All right.
You got another year to prepare for that there, Pat.
That's right. Okay.
Bye, guys.
Bye.
Adios.
All righty. You could actually start with that coming out of the intro, and we could come back to that, because then I'm going to go into Sheep's Head and Barbie dolls. I'll be back. All right. So in other news that may affect the broadcast here, I'm going to be in Milwaukee next week, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday. And I thought that I would be able to broadcast from the Waukesha studio, and come to find out yesterday that that studio will actually be used to engineer the Racine morning show starting next Monday. So I will not.
Unfortunate timing.
Yeah. So that means I will take all this gear and attempt to do Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday shows from my hotel down in Milwaukee. So that may impact things like pre-taping some things and whatnot, right. But we'll give it a go.
It's worked before.
Mm-hmm. Oh yeah. No, it's worked just fine before. I'm not crazy about doing it for 3 days, but we'll see how that goes.
All across Wisconsin from Civic Media, this is Up North News Radio. Now, live from our Lake Wissota studio, here's the founding editor of Up North News, Pat Breitlow.
And welcome back to the second hour of Up North News Radio for this Wednesday, July 26th. Oh yeah, that's right, it's George Clinton's birthday too. No, not that George Clinton. Aaron, come on, man. George Clinton, the fourth vice president of the United States. We talked about this in the last segment. How could you confuse the two?
Well, like you said, there's so many Clintons.
So, yeah, I mentioned George Clinton. I'm going off on this whole thing about, you know, one of our early, you know, political leaders. And, yeah, up comes some great music from a different George Clinton. This Wednesday, July 26th, is also National Aunt and Uncle's Day. And coming up this hour, we're going to talk about the day that Hubert flipped the script. It was 75 years ago, last Friday, that a young Minneapolis mayor named Hubert Humphrey helped his party escape a slide toward irrelevance and find the courage to throw off the dead weight that came from decades of racism or coddling racism. And so Samuel Friedman has a new book called Into the Bright Sunshine, Young Hubert Humphrey and the Fight for Civil Rights, to describe how the future vice president went from naive dreamer to modern leader. And we'll talk to him as well about how Wisconsin leaders at the time handled the long march toward embracing civil rights. So that's coming up at 7:30 this morning. If you missed our last hour, you can catch all of our shows anytime by going to civicmedia.us, where you can find every show, every hour of every show. Listen back there or subscribe to it as a podcast on Spotify and Apple and all those places. We'd love to have you along doing things that way. Or if you want to follow just what Up North News does, because Up North News is a separate entity from Civic Media, our website is upnorthnewswi.com. We put together a newsletter every morning that we feature, put in your mailbox around 5 a.m., help you follow some uniquely and unabashedly Wisconsin stories and headlines. So just go to the website and sign up for the newsletter there, or find everything that we're doing in terms of Up North News on social media. Just look up Up North News WI. Don't forget the WI on a lot of those social media channels. We'd love to have you along. Aaron, I ran out of time to ask Melissa Kay about this in our last segment, but there is a really nice article in the Journal Sentinel. Jordan Nenning is the author, with the headline, "What is Sheep's Head? And why is it so popular in Wisconsin?" And honestly, if I hadn't married into a family that plays Sheep's Head endlessly, I don't even know if I would have understood the headline. But as I say, I did marry into a dairy farm family from Manitowoc County, where they'll play Sheep's Head for 6-8 hours or longer on some Sundays when they get together, and they're not alone. There's a lot of that going on out there. Now, you're from the Manitowoc area. Where are you on Sheep's Head?
See, that's me and my family with cribbage.
See, now that's me and my wife. We play cribbage almost every evening, even though she grew up in a Sheep's Head family. So I totally hear you there.
Yeah, I haven't played Sheep's Head, which is surprising how into card and board games I am. Mm-hmm. I'd like to. It just hasn't happened yet.
And so we asked Melissa, and again, we didn't get time to talk about it on air, if she was a Sheep's Head player. And what did she mention? She mentioned Euchre.
Yes.
And which one of you brought up Pinochle?
She did. She said that she also plays Pinochle.
I did. Honestly, I didn't know anybody still played Pinochle. I've heard of Euchre a lot. I've never played Euchre, but Pinochle is one I haven't heard the word in forever, but clearly it's still out there in some circles.
Yeah. I also said over the break that some people in college learned how to play beer pong or boom cup or whatever else these other drinking games are that I've never played. Mm-hmm. I learned how to play Pinochle.
See, and there was, you know, that long phase where everything was about poker. Everybody was learning poker. Poker was new on TV and everything. And, you know, of course, it's still out there. But for some families, and not just out, you know, in eastern Wisconsin, here in Chippewa County as well, there are Sheep's Head tournaments and things. And so this article that Jordan Nunnig did in the Journal Sentinel is a really good attempt to describe Sheep's Head. And I have to say attempt because, look, I've been exposed to this game for going on 40 years now. And only very recently do I feel like I can actually hold my own when you're sitting there with four other people who are far more experienced playing this card game. And as the article notes, I mean, in some circles, Sheep's Head is synonymous with cheese and beer when it comes to Wisconsin culture. And she explains that there are different ways to play Sheep's Head, which, again, I wouldn't have necessarily known. All we play is five-handed pick jack of diamonds. But there's also a called ace version, which is more popular in the Milwaukee area. There's an attempt to explain the history of Sheep's Head, but like so many things, there really wasn't a definitive history written in the early days. And so it's just a guess, if nothing else. And then it's all about, you know, what are the trump suits, you know, what's high, what's low, how do you score the points, how do you play what on what, which, again, you can do with Euchre, you can do with Pinochle, you can do with bridge and all kinds of things. And I do wonder amongst our own listeners if there is either a favorite or a story about trying to learn a card game and, you know, it worked or it didn't work. And you can call us at 844-967-2789. I actually took several years off of Sheep's Head once when my two nieces, who were like 8 and 10 at the time, rolled their eyes at me at the way that I played a hand. And I said, that's it. If these little girls are going to mock me, I'm clearly not ready for this. And I eventually came back to it. Love to know what you think of that as well. Much more headlines and author Sam Friedman still to come. You're up north. baby. Hi. Hey, Teddy.
Day after day, I'm more confused. Yet I look for the light through the pouring rain.
W. Gray, born this day in 1940, 83 years ago. That, of course, was his big hit here. We've got an update from Weatherology coming up in just a second, right after I tell you that here in Chippewa Falls, we just had some thunder roll through, a little bit of a, some thunderstorm action. I thought I might have seen a watch box here or there as some of the noise went past. A little bit of rain, nothing terrible in our neck of the woods, but let's see how it's looking for the rest of what continues to be a very warm midweek with Jennifer Wachitsky here from Weatherology to give us all the details. Jennifer, good morning.
Good morning. Yeah, and it does look like still a few scattered showers and thunderstorms for most across the listening area, primarily in the morning hours today, then drying out for most by the afternoon, but lingering storm chances in the afternoon hours around Waukesha and Milwaukee. A marginal risk for severe weather today from Milwaukee over to Madison, drying out earlier today around Amory and Baldwin, then becoming mostly sunny there. A hot day for all, but there will be a heat advisory that will go into effect at 10 a.m. Today for just Baldwin, mid to upper 80s for most, around 90s for Madison over to Richland Center, and for the southwestern parts of the state today. Thursday, sunny and dry for the southern half of the state during the daytime hours, and a chance for showers and storms by night. Looks like a chance for storms during the day from Wausau over to west central Wisconsin tomorrow, and it does look like a marginal risk for severe weather tomorrow across most of the state as well. A little bit warmer as we'll see highs mostly in the 90s tomorrow, a few lingering in the 80s closer to Lake Michigan. Friday, a chance for showers and storms across the board, mid to upper 80s for most, in the 90s for southwest Wisconsin. And then for the weekend, it actually looks like a dry forecast and a cooler one at that as well, as a cold front pushes through. Sunny skies both Saturday and Sunday, mid 70s actually to right around about 80 degrees on Saturday, mainly around the low 80s for Sunday.
Best thing to have would be some sunscreen. Otherwise, sunscreen and some pontoon keys would be even better. Jennifer, thank you so much. Have a great day.
You too.
There's Jennifer Wachitsky from Weatherology. Currently 70 degrees up here on Lake Wasota, 70 in La Crosse, 71 in Hayward, 74 degrees right now in Madison. Coming up in just a few minutes here, Samuel Friedman, author of Into the Bright Sunshine, Young Hubert Humphrey, and The Fight for Civil Rights, all about what happened at the Democratic National Convention 75 years ago in getting the party to turn the page on its ways of either being all-out segregationist or simply tolerating the segregationists in the party. So look for that coming up in just a few minutes. The Milwaukee Brewers still lead the National League Central Division, but only by a half game after losing to the Cincinnati Reds last night. The Brewers had trailed 4-0 heading into the ninth inning, almost came all the way back. Christian Yelich had a 3-run homer with two outs in the bottom of the ninth, but eventually the Reds were able to get the final out and get that 4-3 victory. They'll play again this afternoon. It will be their 13th and final matchup of the regular season. They really crammed a lot of their division games into the middle part of the season, where the Reds have only won three of the 12 games so far against the Brewers. The same Reds team has gone 32-9 against all the other teams since May 25th. And again, you can catch today's game with Freddie Peralta on the mound at WRCE News from the Center and Richland Center, or Oshkosh Air Support, 98.3 FM. The Brewers are off tomorrow. Then they travel to Atlanta and then to Washington, D.C. to play the Nationals. They'll be back home next Thursday for a division series against the Pirates. I hear grandchildren waking up in the distance in case you hear any protests about, you know, whether they can have cake for breakfast or grandma's cookies that she made yesterday. I have to tell you about an article I just saw, an opinion piece. I saw it in the Journal Sentinel, but it's actually from Amelia Robinson, who is an editor, an opinion and community engagement editor with the Columbus Dispatch. And it's about not just about the Barbie movie and about Barbies, but the predictable, if not somewhat upsetting backlash to all of it. And the headline on it being failed Barbie backlash as part of the war on magic, creativity, joy, and human potential. And while I would understand if people said you're being hyperbolic, when you see and hear some of the backlash to the Barbie movie, you understand that it's not, that there's just a troubling segment of the population that is very much in line with something we talked about in the last hour. And that, again, is views on masculinity and how many people, including a majority of Republican voters in a public opinion poll, who said the best way to raise children is to have, you know, two parents at home, a man who's the breadwinner and a woman who stays home and raises the children. You know, the Leave It to Beaver scenario that happened far less often than people think. Again, this whole notion that there was some kind of a fairy tale in America's past, and if only we could get back to that. And that was never the case. And so looking at this opinion piece by Amelia Robinson, she talked about the way that, you know, what happened with the Barbie movie has triggered anti-magic, creativity, joy, and human potential crusaders. And even though Barbie did well with a $155 million box office opening weekend, you know, there's still plenty of people who look at Barbie and dismiss it for all the wrong reasons. For example, thinking of Barbie as some kind of a one-dimensional bimbo, when whatever Barbie may have been decades before, Barbie is now a rock star, a school teacher, a doctor, a ballerina, a mother, a fast driver, an Olympic swimmer, a model, a journalist. Barbie still has an itty bitty waist that does not sit well with some people, nor the hot pink Porsche. But Barbie also is no longer just blonde haired and blue eyed. You know, the dolls are black. They are brown. They're Kens. You know, they were at times married to Spider-Man and G.I. Joe. And, you know, they had all kinds of different lives. And yet there is this backlash, the word I keep using here, from people like, you know, one well-known conservative commentator. I'm not even going to mention his name, but he writes, "All you need to know about Barbie is that it unironically uses the word patriarchy more than 10 times. And, you know, talked about dressing up like Ken and setting some Barbie dolls on fire as part of this whole anti-woke rant." And that's really what this comes into, is this pushback against, you know, creativity and joy and human potential, as she writes. There's, you know, legislation pending that talks about wokeness as some kind of a gateway drug. And what she writes here, and this is the quote that really stuck out at me. "In other words, it makes some people very, very uncomfortable to see women out of the kitchen, black people out of the field, and gay people out of the closet. And it's why there is this campaign to cast certain books and lesson plans as evil indoctrinating villains, whether they be historical, cultural, or fictional. It's why artists, not just drag queens, but going back to Michelangelo, have been demonized as vulgar." And she writes, "It's why large American cities have been painted as wicked and dangerous places. Those who seek to smother out magic, creativity, joy, and human potential have a reason to fear." Because she writes, as the famous saying goes, "If you can imagine it, you can achieve it. If you can dream it, you can become it." If you can imagine a just world where people live freely, you might just do the things it takes to make this world the world of your dreams. You might be the one, Amelia Robinson concludes, with the Barbie dream house, with dolls in a variety of skin colors, sizes, ethnicities, sexual orientations, and gender. And I think what she and I and others are trying to say is, what the hell is wrong with that? Mike from Oklahoma joins us to talk a bit about the subject. Mike, good morning.
Good morning. Thank you. I have this word kiwiness is a newly added word to the Oxford Dictionary in 2023. Kiwiness, like a kiwi fruit.
Okay.
You type that into Rumble. It's a monetized dictionary word.
Okay.
Changes the game a little bit if there's only one video there, right? For a dictionary word.
Mm-hmm.
So if I said, how come people don't know how to monetize words yet, but we all know what pictures on the blockchain are? Because I think I just made a fortune off your audience. They add a hashtag, it goes to a second level. And Jennifer Sulzberger has a patent on that. And all the elected officials who don't use signs outside with a vocabulary word on it to generate views are missing out on encouraging literacy.
Okay. All right. Well, I appreciate that, Mike, but we'll try to keep things to the Barbie movie and, you know, not do our own little pitches for blockchains or what have you here. So again, if you have some input on actually seeing the movie, and by the way, I was hoping that today was going to be the day I was going to tell you about seeing it. That was the original plan, again, with the daughters and the grandkids here in town, that we were going to go see the Barbie movie. It's still sold out up here in Chippewa Falls. So we will get to it maybe as early as today if we get tickets early enough. And I still plan to see Oppenheimer as well. So we definitely will have some movie magic to chatter about. Right now, though, I'm relying on people like Amelia Robinson's critique to tell us more about the Barbie movie. And I also figured out, Aaron, why I have been saying the other movie's name wrong occasionally, instead of saying Oppenheimer the way that I should. And I'm like, where's this coming from? I realized I'm from the Midwest. We say Ope all the time.
Yep.
So why wouldn't Oppenheimer fall out of your mouth?
I figured that's what it was.
Just so look, that one needs to be there as well, and we'll look at that and see what people think. I don't know. Mark from Prairie du Sac calls in frequently and is calling in here. So I don't know, Mark, if you've seen one movie or the other, or want to comment on Amelia Robinson's critique about, you know, the toxic masculinity pushback to it. How are you this morning?
Yeah, I'm doing pretty good, and I won't be able to see a movie now for probably a few weeks. I've still got a chest tube in me with a
kind
of uncomfortable collection box alongside me. But I'm looking forward to seeing the Barbie movie. I like this, you know, kind of out there little thing that, and actually, you know, it's amazing to me that this is, it sounds like a movie that makes people, can make people think. And the reaction that I'm getting from, the reaction the right wing is having is making me more interested in seeing the movie, you know, in the first place. I mean, these people are having a meltdown over a movie, over a fun, what sounds like a really fun movie, and poking a little fun at the patriarchy and trying to make a point that, you know, that we should be making a lot, should have made a lot more progress than we apparently, we haven't had, and that people are still trying to drag us back to some fictionalized version of the 50s where father knows best and Leave It to Beaver, and that world just never really existed.
No, it never did. Mark, you are sounding so much better. Thank you. I hope the recovery continues going well, and we'll both compare notes on the movie real soon, okay? Thank you, sir. Appreciate it. You know, and that's the other thing. I mean, look, I'll be the first to admit, the first time I saw the Barbie movie trailer, I rolled my eyes, and then as I learned more about, you know, that it was Greta Gerwig who was directing it, you knew it was going to be something smart, and I'm looking forward to seeing it. Author Sam Friedman is coming up next, and we're talking about a major turning point for the Democratic Party 75 years ago. Next, you're up north.
Sorry I left that guy on the line so long. I kept expecting him to maybe turn things around.
I was too, you know, and as soon as he said making money off the audience, I'm like, okay, you get like five more seconds, and you know,
yeah,
it happens. It's, you know, blockchain. The fact that, yeah, I know. All right, so let's bring in Sam here. Sam, how are you?
I'm doing well. That was a pretty weird exchange, all right. I kept wondering what the scam exactly was.
I know. It happens from time to time, and you just got to ride with it. So anyway, yeah. Hey, thanks again so much for doing this. I really appreciate it.
Oh, no, it's my pleasure. Thanks for having me on. And yeah. I'm a UW alum, so doing something in Wisconsin feels especially great.
Oh, that's great. No, I appreciate that. Quick reminder, we're in a commercial break for about another 3.5 minutes here. Folks watching us on Facebook can still see and hear us, but we'll be back to the radio audience here in just a second. I don't think there's any new information I need to share with you other than to, again, underscore, you know, and feel free to let me know what you do or don't have. But obviously, to the extent that you can comment on any Wisconsin folks, you know, who are mentioned in the book or their tangential effect on all of this, whether it's Alexander Wiley or Joe McCarthy or somebody else, you know, feel free to apply that liberally to the discussion.
No, there's actually a great Wisconsin angle that comes in right at the crescendo of the book with Humphrey's civil rights speech. He couldn't have given it without some really smart political maneuvering by a guy named Andy B. Miller, who I'll talk about.
Oh, perfect. Okay, good. I'll definitely look forward to that here. And let's see, was I going to mention something? Oh, I'm just going to say, and Aaron, our producer, he knows as well. Usually we come out of the commercial break with some music, but I'm actually going to come out with the main 40-second clip of Humphrey's speech, and then I'll go into the introduction of you. And then we have a hard out at 7:48. And so I'm hoping to time it out so that we actually play the last couple sentences of Humphrey's speech as well, but we'll see how that goes along. So
great.
Just a little production note about that. It was only after, I think it was probably hours after I first communicated with you, that I saw I want to say it was a replay of Morning Joe, and saw that you were on there like the same day or the day prior. And I'm glad we got 15 minutes here, but I'm telling you, the time just flies, and it's, you know, these interviews would be so great. And I hope you're getting to do a few long form interviews along the way as well.
It's been really good. I've had rollout on this book unlike anything I've experienced in 36 years and 9 previous books. And for long form, I just recorded Fresh Air yesterday. So that's such a high point for any author to be on Fresh Air.
Oh, yeah. Oh, that's great. Okay.
And actually, I don't know if repeat visits are ever possible, but I'm going to do a couple of book events in November.
Absolutely.
In state, I'm going to do it at the State Historical Society in Madison. Mm-hmm. And then haven't found a place yet, but I'll be working with a very progressive Lutheran pastor in Milwaukee, Lisa Bates Froilan, to do something in Milwaukee about Humphrey and religion and Excellent. Sort of the role of liberal religion.
Okay. Good, good. Looking forward to that. All right. We're going to get going in about 45 seconds. So I'm just going to put us in the background here, and we'll be right up. All right, we're going to go in 10 seconds. Our mics will be open while we play this Hubert clip. Here we go.
To those who say, my friends, to those who say that we are rushing this issue of civil rights, I say to them, we are 172 years late. To those who say that this civil rights program is an infringement on states' rights, I say this. The time has arrived in America for the Democratic Party to get out of the shadows of states' rights and to walk forthrightly into the bright sunshine of human rights.
That is a young Hubert Humphrey at the 1948 Democratic National Convention, before he became a long-serving U.S. Senator from Minnesota and Vice President of the United States. Back then, he was the mayor of Minneapolis, but his remarks that day in Philadelphia, 75 years ago last week, helped drag the Democratic Party, some of them kicking and screaming, away from the shame of segregation or the equally shameful trait of timidity and kowtowing to the racists. Humphrey spoke for those who knew Democrats had become a permanent minority or even a non-entity in places like Wisconsin, and that it was past time to fight for a platform language that supported civil rights for Black Americans. Author Samuel Friedman has written a new book, Into the Bright Sunshine, Young Hubert Humphrey and the Fight for Civil Rights. And he joins us this morning here on Up North News Radio. Sam Friedman, good morning.
It's great to be with you, Pat. Thanks so much for having me on.
Yeah, thank you again for being part of this. Now, I will confess to the listeners, as I did to you, my interest here is beyond the norm, having been raised both in the Twin Cities as well as in Eau Claire. Mm-hmm. And that Senator Humphrey was a larger-than-life elder statesman in my younger years until his passing in 1978. And it surprised me later in life, and kind of does to this day, that history has not given Humphrey his due. And understandably, the Vietnam War and the 1968 presidential campaign, you know, were central to that. But now with the passage of time, it's easier to kind of separate the layers. And so if we can set aside the layers of the 1960s, and examine the period of the late 40s and 50s, where did Hubert Humphrey leave his mark on history?
Well, Hubert Humphrey was one of the most important civil rights leaders in this country for a long period of time, especially during the 1940s, which is kind of this overlooked but really essential period of civil rights activity. Humphrey was right there alongside people like A. Philip Randolph, the great Black labor and civil rights leaders, and Walter White, the NAACP, in pushing forward on civil rights in a decade when fighting the war against global fascism had inevitably raised the question of what America was going to do about the forms of intolerance and racial supremacy and religious bigotry here in the homeland. And he was one of the most important voices on that issue. And starting out as mayor in Minneapolis, just a few miles up 94 from where you are in Chippewa Falls, he made Minneapolis a national model of progress on civil rights, coming out of a period when Minneapolis had been deservedly reviled as one of the most discriminatory cities in the whole country against Blacks and also against Jews.
As well as it and St. Paul were just these huge centers of gangland activity as well. And so you had crusaders like Humphrey that, perhaps some other Midwestern cities didn't have and would have been wise to have. But I will ask it this way. Why was it him in 1948? Was it a case of, let this young upstart mayor, let him go out there and commit political suicide? Or was he indeed a motivator and a leader, matched the expectations others put in him?
The answer, Pat, is both. He was on a mission, and I've often said that the question was whether it was a political suicide mission, but he firmly believed in it. And just to sort of contextualize for your listeners and your online viewers, as great a president as Franklin Roosevelt was, he'd never been willing to confront the Southern segregationist wing of the party on the Jim Crow system, not in his platform, not in the way New Deal programs were written, not in the way they were administered locally. And Harry Truman was of two minds heading into the 48 election. Partly he was advancing on civil rights, and then the closer he got to the election, the more he wanted to back away and just kick that can down the road the way FDR had. And you also had Southern segregationists saying, we're going to bolt from the party if you do anything on civil rights. And then finally, you had A. Philip Randolph, who I mentioned before, leading a mass movement to have Black young men not register for the draft or not serve unless Harry Truman desegregated the military. And so into this turmoil, here's Humphrey as part of an insurgency within the Democratic Party, pushing a real civil rights plank, something that explicitly says we're going to integrate the military, we're going to have fair employment practices, we're going to put an end to lynching, and so forth. And partly because of his emerging national reputation, and partly because of his great oratorical skills, he's given the task of selling this platform plank to the whole convention. That happens July 14th, 1948, and it's not just that he's talking to 1,500 delegates and alternates, and it's not just that he's talking to 15,000 people in the convention hall. Believe it or not, there are 70 million people watching on TV or listening on radio to that speech in real time. It's like the Super Bowl in terms of audience.
That's a great point as well, because again, political conventions were, well, they weren't the produced stage shows that right. they are today. Actual business happened there. And in that age of radio and early TV, I mean, people really hung on what was in a party platform. It told you quite literally what it stood for compared to, say, the 2020 Republican Party, which said, we're not going to have a platform. It's whatever Donald Trump wants,
right.
which just tells you how far we've come. Let's get to the Wisconsin tie for a moment here and start in Wisconsin. Now, we know one of Wisconsin's U.S. senators back then was Joseph McCarthy, and history has given him all the scorn he deserves, and we can get to him. But I also want to make note that Wisconsin's other senator at the time, Alexander Wiley, was from right here in Chippewa Falls. And so I wanted to know, between Wiley, McCarthy, other Wisconsin figures, you know, to what degree did they figure either into Humphrey's moves or other either support or opposition to embracing civil rights?
Well, there's a great Wisconsin angle here that I'm very happy to share. You know, Humphrey couldn't just stand up and give the speech because he wanted to give the speech. There was a whole complicated process of how you put a platform plank up to all the delegates. And it wasn't easy to do, especially when the incumbent president wanted to have this quashed in committee. And one of Humphrey's most important allies was a labor leader and former member of Congress from Milwaukee, and former member before that, the state legislature, named Andrew B. Miller, who everyone called Andy. And Andy B. Miller was an expert in parliamentary procedure. And not only was he allied with Humphrey on civil rights, but he understood all these abstruse and intricate rules on how, even if you had lost on your platform plank in the platform committee, which Humphrey had, you could get a second chance speaking to the whole convention. And it actually shocked Truman's people who were running the convention that Andy B. Miller knew how to maneuver it so that Humphrey could get to give the speech. And he and Humphrey had been planning this out for weeks ahead. Heading into the convention, Humphrey goes down to the Milwaukee area where Andy B. Miller has a house a little bit outside Milwaukee, sort of in the Pewaukee area, if not in Pewaukee itself. And they map out, here's how we're going to make sure that we are able to give the speech, even if we lose at an earlier stage. So B. Miller is one of the unsung heroes of this. And of course, the Wisconsin delegation at the convention votes in favor of this plank. As you said, this was a really key issue in many parts of the country, not just states that had a large number of Black voters, where you had a lot of big city political bosses saying, we've got to endorse civil rights because we've got to improve turnout, or not only are we going to lose the presidency, but we're going to lose all the down ballot races. But you had states like Wisconsin with this, you know, progressive and liberal tradition, also, unfortunately, that counter tradition of people like Joe McCarthy, but at least in the Democratic Party, a tradition that wanted to keep moving forward with a liberal agenda. And civil rights in 48 was the key part of that agenda.
And it was, because, again, for folks who might be too young to really appreciate this, the Civil Rights Act of 1964 didn't happen in a vacuum. This was decades in the making of filibuster after filibuster after filibuster, primarily from, you know, Democrats and Southern Democrats at the time. And it took people like Hubert Humphrey and others to flip the script. And so you hear people today saying, well, you know, our party, the Republican Party, our party is the party of Lincoln, and your party is the one of segregation. Well, yeah, once upon a time, mm-hmm. but you're kind of ignoring history, especially 1948, if you're still sticking to that trope.
Exactly. What happens in 1948 is, when the civil rights plank wins and Harry Truman ends up needing to run as a civil rights candidate, and 2 weeks after the convention, he issues executive orders desegregating the military and desegregating the federal workforce. That's the realignment we're living with now. That moment sets Democrats enduringly on the path to being a multiracial, interfaith party of inclusive democracy. When the Dixiecrats, Southern Democrats, leave, that's the beginning of the process that will lead them to become Republicans, starting with Barry Goldwater in 64, Nixon in 68, Reagan in 80, and now Donald Trump, in 16 and 20 and probably 24 as well. So it is when the script gets flipped, and it's so intellectually dishonest to say that the Democrats still are the party of segregation. when they ousted their extremists in 1948, they did what the Republicans have been totally unwilling to do with Trump and with the Trump movement, which is kick out the crazies, kick out the bigots.
Right. And it's not a given that the GOP would simply accept having the script flipped and allow itself to become the modern day bastion of opposition to civil rights, voting rights, diversity, equity, and inclusion, and even an honest teaching of American history. So what led the party of Lincoln to become the party of Lee Atwater and Karl Rove and now Donald Trump?
Well, the first thing that happens is you have the Goldwater insurgency in 64. That's the kind of the beginning of the rise of the new right, even though by today's standards, Goldwater would probably be in the Lincoln Project. But Goldwater comes out against civil rights laws. He doesn't seem to be personally bigoted, but he makes this argument of quote unquote states' rights. And that's a dog whistle to Southern segregationists to vote for him, especially when he's running against LBJ in 64, who's already pushed through, with Hubert Humphrey's help, the Civil Rights Act of 64. Although Goldwater loses massively, it's a sign that Republicans can get votes from the segregationists of the South. And Richard Nixon then in 68, who'd previously been pretty progressive on civil rights. In fact, Martin Luther King almost endorsed Nixon for president in 1960. Richard Nixon runs on the so-called Southern strategy, which means, again, to appeal to this opposition to civil rights in the South, and moves forward on that progress. Ronald Reagan, again, someone who I don't think at a personal level was a bigot, but is willing to play that card, starts the 1980 campaign with rally in Philadelphia, Mississippi, near the place where the three civil rights martyrs, Cheney, Schwerner, and Goodman, were murdered by white vigilantes. So this is all a process that moves along. And even though there are some Republican candidates who push against it and try to bring it back towards the party of Lincoln, like John McCain, and with all of his other flaws, George W. Bush, I think, was the best Republican president on race since Lincoln. But they lose control of the party, and now we are where we are. And that's a point where you can't even teach honestly about slavery anymore.
Isn't that something? So my last question, I've got a minute for this, is what are the chances this can flip again, say 75 years from now? Can we say that some young Republican halted their party's march toward extremism and irrelevance the way the Democrats faced it back then? Or is the money too much? Is the media infrastructure too rigid for the Republican Party to change its ways?
I think they have to lose a lot more elections and lose them badly, and then hopefully someone will emerge. Either that or the party will formally crack into two things, and one part of it will take up the voice of what the Republican Party used to be on issues of racial equality.
Samuel Friedman is an award-winning professor, columnist, author of 9 acclaimed books, a staff reporter from the New York Times from 81 to 87, and so much more. And the book, again, is called Into the Bright Sunshine, Young Hubert Humphrey and the Fight for Civil Rights. Sam, thank you so much. It was great to be able to talk to you, and let's do it again a little later as you're making this book tour.
I totally enjoyed it, Pat. I'll be very glad to be back. Thanks so much.
Thank you. All right, back with Todd Alba after this. You're up north.
And equality wisely well. My good friends, I ask my party, I ask the Democratic Party, to march down the high road of progressive democracy. I ask this convention to say in unmistakable terms that we proudly hail and we courageously support our president and leader, Harry Truman, in his great fight for civil rights in America.
Very nice. All right, we're in commercial. Sam, thank you again. This was wonderful.
Oh, that was great, Pat. I hope we can do it again.
Absolutely. Keep me up to speed on the book tour, and we'll get together soon.
I'll definitely do. Once we get things locked in for those Wisconsin book talks, I'll drop a note to you.
All right. Sounds great. Have a great day.
Thanks. You too. Take good care.
Yep. You as well. Mr. Alba. Todd Alba. He can't hear us.
Can you hear us?
Can you hear me?
Oh, there. I can hear you.
We can hear you.
Can you not hear us?
All right.
Uh-oh.
I don't know. I got everything loaded up this time, so I don't know. I can't hear you guys, but as long as you can hear me, that's fine.
I don't know that it works that way. we're hearing you. It's going to make things a little... All right. I wish I could like type right on screen. You know, we could type our questions to them.
Yes, sir. Yeah, I don't know why I can't hear you guys. I have my return. I have my return turned up. So I don't know. I guess as long as you can hear me, I should be able to hear you when we go live. Well, it'll make a difference. It'll be different, won't it? I mean, I can hear. Let me plug it in my computer. All right, now say something when you're on the stream.
Hello.
Hello. Okay. Good.
You hear all right, me on now the screen? Now I can hear. I don't know why I can't hear it on my board, but all right, it's working.
Okay. All thank right. You. Here we go.
Clowns to the left of me, jokers to the right. Here I am, stuck in the middle with you. Yes, I'm stuck in the middle with you.
Okay, here's something about the different approaches that we have here is that for Todd Alba, who likes to think of himself as somewhat of a moderate these days, he's got Steelers wheel stuck in the middle with you. I kick off my show every day with Stevie Ray Vaughan talking about being caught in the crossfire. We're just a couple of average American boys who want us all to get along a little bit better. And I'm glad that we had that author, Sam Friedman, on just now to talk about how Hubert Humphrey tried to play a role in that. Todd Alba, if we don't have any tech glitches and you can hear me, how are you?
I'm okay. Can you hear me?
Yeah, hear you just great.
Okay. All right, fantastic. It all works. So yeah, he was fantastic. I was listening a little bit before I came on, and always good to go back and remember history to try not to repeat it, right?
Yeah. Well, it was encouraging to be reminded of how Hubert Humphrey came to become, a political hero for a time. Obviously, it was tainted a bit by losing to Richard Nixon in 1968. But I have to say, it was also rather maddening, and you would appreciate this more than me, I think, having worked in the Republican Party. Mm. But for me to be reminded that this isn't before it was Donald Trump's party, it was Karl Rove. And before Karl Rove, it was Lee Atwater. And I don't say this, I do not say this lightly. There are very few people that I would reserve a special place in hell for. And for me, what Lee Atwater did to the Republican Party, embracing as much of the racist tropes as he did to help out for the greater good, Karl Rove was just the latest in that line. And it genuinely makes me angry to think about the people that would basically, they may not, it's not that they started out as racist, but they see racism as a political strategy to victory. And that enrages me.
Stuart Stevens, who is part of the Lincoln Project, who's been our show once and hopefully get it back again. He wrote a great book, which I'm in the middle of rereading again, which is called It Was All a Lie, How the Republican Party Became Donald Trump. And for me, who spent 30 years as a Republican and left in 2011, it's both cathartic and maddening. And there's even some humor thrown in there as well. I think your point is a great one, Pat. And that is, and I really appreciated your guest saying, you know, George W. Bush was probably the most progressive on civil rights, since Richard Nixon in terms of Republican presidents and administrations. And even he, of course, was influenced and got into office with the help of Karl Rove. So I think a lot of times there's these kind of figure people in the party who are not necessarily racist or bad people themselves. I don't believe that George Bush is, but it's these people that are the mechanics, the people running the machine on the inside that get into these parties that quite frankly don't have the courage or the ability to run for office themselves and so create chaos. You might be able to remember the name. I can't remember it. And as a gay person myself, it infuriates me. But there was a Republican operative for years, the Republican Party, who himself was closeted gay and ran some of the most atrocious, terrible anti-gay ads for Republicans across the country. And that's the kind of party that it has been in all – now, again, I don't want to paint all Republicans that way. My former boss, Dale Schultz and Scott Klug, certainly not in that camp. There are others, but I think we're looking at the mechanics of the party at the top tiers nationally, and now even little by little at the state level. It's extraordinarily disturbing, particularly for someone who spent so many years in that party.
It you remind me that both George W. Bush and George H.W. Bush, and frankly, Richard Nixon, who looks like, you know, a lefty loon, you know, through the prism of history for embracing the Clean Air Act, the Clean Water Act, and things like that, that there's a difference between how you govern versus how you win an election. And I am completely guilty here of painting with an overly broad brush. But Democrats fall short far too often saying, I'm going to campaign on ideas and policy, and when I win, I will put those in effect. And Republicans, and again, I am being overly cynical, but not unwarranted, that we'll do whatever we got to win. If we got to use, you know, various tactics of fear and whatnot, we may actually be quite moderate, but we got to win this election. So we're going to do what we got to do.
Yeah, I think that's very true. Again, painting with very broad brushes. I brought this movie up before, and, you know, Primary Colors from there was a novel, first of all, and then a movie. Yes. And I watch it usually a couple times a year just because it makes me laugh, partly. I love Billy Bob Thornton in the movie. But it kind of drives home this point, right, that in the movie, which is based supposedly on the primary of Bill Clinton in 92, yeah. That he was a very flawed individual and was surrounded by people that would do anything to get him there. But he himself was in it for the right reasons. Mm-hmm. And basically the movie makes you think, does the ends justify the means?
Yeah.
And that's
what
so much of politics is about.
Well, and I think if we're going to actually flip this around and talk about Democrats, I think one of the things that's especially maddening to voters, especially the further left they are, is that you have Democratic candidates who run embracing a lot of left-leaning provisions, but then they're perceived as far too moderate or cautious or timid when they get into office. Now, maybe some of that is the realities of trying to get something passed through Congress, but I would argue as well, you know, especially somebody like a Joe Biden. Joe Biden talks a good game, but he was never a flaming liberal when it comes to the policies, even though he's also the guy who, like Humphrey, you know, was reading the temperature in the room and saying, hey, guys, we got to embrace, you know, same-sex marriage. He got ahead of his boss, President Obama, at that point. But by and large, he doesn't have that reputation.
Yeah, I you're right. It happens on both sides of the party. I was never obviously in your caucuses on the Democratic side, but on the Republican side, you know, my boss is one of them. There were others where when you first get to Madison or to Washington and you have kind of these pure high ideals that you run on and you actually believe them. But part of the problem is, Pat, agree or disagree, you get in those caucuses and you're surrounded by even 10, 20 years ago, loons or far right or far left people that muck up the inner workings of the caucus. It has to be even 10 times worse today. So even a person that goes in for the right reason with the right intent, once you get there to achieve what you ran on, is sometimes virtually impossible because you can't get the caucus to give you the votes.
I'll never forget the 2010 running for re-election to the legislature and obviously lost later that year. It was the Tea Party year and people were seeing the writing on the walls. And I remember a couple of supporters, you know, confronting me and saying, you know, we're not going to donate to you anymore or support you until you get in front of a TV camera and promise to raise taxes for education. And I remember looking at them saying something along the lines of, I'm sorry, and I will miss your $50.
That's right.
Because, you know, you're actually looking to win so you can support education. Todd Alba, you find him weekdays 1 to 3 across Civic Media's radio network. Thank you, sir. Have a great day.
Thank you, Pat.
All right. And thank you, everybody, for being here as well. You can follow me on the face page over there. Just go to Pat Kreitlow Up North or Pat Kreitlow on Twitter. I'm on the new Threads as well. And you can sign up for our daily newsletter at UpNorthNewsWI.com. Have a great Wednesday. See you tomorrow.